Yay, how are you doing? Awesome, still full of energy and vitality. How about we pray for that? Fresh strength injected into everyone. From late nights and early mornings, God, but we just pray for an injection of your glory, your presence. Thank you. Keep coming, Holy Spirit. Isn't he awesome? You can just feel a building and a building and a building. Just picked up Heidi Baker from the airport, so she's on tonight. That'll be exciting. She's just resting right now. But this is the House of Prayer team. We have a House of Prayer here in Catch the Fire Toronto that plays now, entering 18 hours a week of worship and intercession here in this house, just, you know, going after the glory and the presence of God in a sustained place of prayer. So this is our team that is playing this afternoon, and then they're going to come back up again after the speaking part. So we're kind of going to, you know, do it, model it, and I want you to just, you know, soak in it, saturate in it. Amen? Wow. Woohoo! Yay! What an exciting time to be alive. Isn't this awesome? So thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing and all that you're building in this phenomenal time of gathering in your presence. Yay! We ask for more. We ask for increase. Ha, ha, ha. Whoa, woo, let your word go forth. And God, we just pray that even in the singing and in these antiphonal singing, the singing this afternoon and the worship, oh Lord, that you would take us into other realms of glory, God. Rain down as we rend our hearts, oh God, rend the heavens, we pray, in new ways and new levels. Every person here, it's my prayer for lasting fruit in every heart, every life. Lasting fruit. Fruit that remains. Next week, next year, next decade. Fruit that remains, we pray, oh God, from our time this week. Thank you, Lord. Keep coming, Holy Spirit. Woo! So let's all stand and let's worship him and exalt his name. May he be made famous in this place.
Hold our hands out. Jesus. Father, we thank you that you are already in this place. Father, we thank you for all that you've been doing here in this place the last couple of days. Father, we ask for more. Holy Spirit, would you come? Would you fill us up now? Spirit, would you come? Would you fall in this life? Fall
Oh, praise it. Oh, praise it. Banqueting table. Ever present God in time of
You rest in who you are in our midst.
Not share your glory. bride, your beautiful bride. We are making ourselves ready for the consummation, arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. At the sound of intercession, filling up the golden bowls, we are bursting in your beauty and your might. And the prayer room in heaven and on earth has come together, and your reign of love will rule the universe.
We are making.
We are making ourselves ready for the consummation, arrayed in fine linen and bright. We'll be ready with the sound of it. I'm bursting in your beauty and your mind. And the prayer room in heaven and on earth has come together. Your reign of love will rule the universe. And the prayer room, and the prayer room in heaven and on earth has come together. Your reign of love will rule. And the prayer room in heaven and on earth has come together. The reign of love will rule the universe. And the prayer room in heaven and on earth has come together. It's the pleasure of loving you. It's the joy of being lost here. It's the pleasure of loving you. Make us love sick. It's the joy of being lost, tender heart. It's the pleasure of loving you, sensitive to you. It's the joy of being lost sick. It's the pleasure of loving you. I see a bride that longs for you at every moment. And our very beings cry out for the living God. And when we wake, the best thought that we can think of is you, Jesus. You'd be a bride that longs for her bridegroom.
Da 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 da. Jesus, I love you.
Jesus, I love you. It's so sweet. I love you. Jesus, I love you. I love you. So friendly. I love you. I love you. Jesus, I love you. Would you just lift your own love song to him? It's whatever he means to you. He loves to hear your voice. Introduce yourself to us, and we have eternal relationship with you. We get to be met with love moment by moment. We thank you for your love here in this place. Thank you for your love.
Soaking in that, bathing in that. Just seemed so right for the afternoon, didn't it? But lift your hands to him and tell him, Jesus, it's really true. I'm not just singing words or mouthing words with my mind somewhere else. I really love you today. You're awesome in every way. You're amazing, constantly amazing. Your goodness and your mercy endure forever. When we gather once again this afternoon in your presence to be strengthened and encouraged and to remind ourselves of the goodness of God and all that you have done for us and you're in the midst of doing and will be doing in our lives. We love you, not just for what you do for us, but really for who you are, because you're amazing, you're great, you're fantastic, the lover of our soul. Thank you, Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, our King. Amen. Amen. All right, well, greet somebody near you and say, man, it's good to see you, good to meet you. It really, really is. And we have folks that have come gathered from many nations, and we're just delighted that you have come from all over the place. And It'd be good to hear from someone. Do we have any other groups that are here apart from Korea? We prayed for them the other day. But did you come in a group or a small group with people? Anyone? A group from here or there or Canada or America or drove up from anywhere? You got some folks from Northern Ireland? Where are you guys? Northern Ireland. Oh, well, come on up here and we'll just get to say hello to you. Yeah, come on. If you can negotiate these stairs. They were put in just for me to be a shortcut to get up here. The safe ones are on the both end, you know. But this is great. I'm going to be going to Ireland in November, actually. Second week. We're going to Dublin and then to Belfast. So that's good, isn't it? Where are you from?
We're from Antrim, in County Antrim, Northern Ireland.
And where is that near?
It's near Belfast.
George McMurtry.
Yeah. We're talking about a guy, George McMurtry, who came really, really ill with several strokes that he had had. Is that right? Strokes? Five strokes. And he sat back there and had a big cast kind of brace on his leg. And Bill Prankard was doing the Tuesday meeting before the conference started on Wednesday. And just right in the meeting, I don't think anybody had even had prayer yet. The power of the Lord came upon him. He burst out of the brace and the business on his leg. His skinny, atrophied leg grew instantly to a normal leg. He got out of his seat and came running right up here. It's an amazing video, isn't it? So you guys all know George. You see, we got four catchers automatically came to stand behind you. Isn't this super? Let's pray for these guys in Ireland, you know. Thank God in the past, Ireland has carried the torch of revival and spread it all around the world. And it's time again for Ireland to catch on fire. And so send it up here, won't you? Come on, stretch your hands out toward her. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray that the anointing of the Holy Spirit will come mightily upon them all. Let the glory come. Oh, yes, Lord, do it, do it, do it, do it. Fill her here. Fill him here. In the name of Jesus, and let your kingdom just come to them and be mightily upon them. Let them take a wonderful dose of the Holy Ghost home to their people. I just want to say that we have a high value on being overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit. How many think that's a good thing? Because we don't want to go back to church the way we used to do it, with very little presence, where the Holy Spirit got a mention once in a while, and fond memories, you know. We want him to come and powerfully touch the hearts and lives of people. And that's why we want to pray for people like that. How many have not had prayer yet? You've been here all week, no one has prayed with you. I hope I don't see any hands. Good. Well, we want to do that again and again and again. Maybe we'll do it this afternoon. Maybe we'll do it tonight. But always hold your heart open for the Holy Spirit to come and fill you yet again and give you more. And I'll tell you why. You are absolutely at your best when you're full of the Holy Spirit. And, of course, we can't be responsible for what happens when you go home. Steve mentioned this morning that I used to remind myself that leaders would go home from here with two fears. How many heard him say that? Do you remember what he said? First fear was, oh, God, what if I go home and nothing happens? Oh, I can't stand it if nothing happens, if we have to stay the way we were. And they're just working through that one. And then they'd go, wait a minute, what if something happens? And I tell you what, there's a price to pay for carrying the Holy Spirit around with you, but you'll be signing up for more fun than you've ever had in all your life, so let's go. Deborah, you're sitting down there. She's here in Toronto for the first time, all the way from Scotland. Run up here, sweetie, and just share something. She's a very, very prophetic young lady that my daughter Vicky knows, and I know, and Carol knows. Came with us on at least one outreach. And here we are in Kenya in an Anglican church, and she kept doing that. But it was good, wasn't it? So say hi to the folks.
Hi.
Give them a good Scottish prophetic word or something. We like it when people just stand up here and do that and they can't talk. It's really good, isn't it? But I just think there's something brewing in there. So let's just wait. Just ask your friend, how are you doing? And is everything okay at home?
The Lion of Judah.
Whoa.
Is roaming about.
Whoa.
And I saw a picture. And it was the picture in Narnia where the army has been turned to stone and frozen. And the Lion of Judah, Aslan, comes and he blows and roars over the army and they come back to life. And the Lion of Judah is here to come and blow over to blow over people, over churches, over nations, over circumstances, where you have felt frozen, where you have felt stuck. He comes to blow, to bring forward movement, and to bring life, 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 life. Back into people, situations, circumstances, churches, nations. So Jesus, the Lion of Judah, would you come and would you blow over your people here? Would you blow over their circumstances where they have felt frozen, where they have felt stuck? He comes to bring breakthrough. To bring freedom and to bring life. So yeah, would you come and do what you want to do, God? Come and blow on your people. Roar over them, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Let's all stand, shall we? How many would like Aslan, i.e. Jesus, come and blow over you right here? Blow the complacency out of us, Father. There's far too much yet to do for any one of us in this room to get used to this and grow complacent. We absolutely set our face to seek your face. And we want you full on, Holy Spirit. Absolutely full on. Don't you just hold your hands out to him like some of you are doing. Let that anointing come on you. Just let it rest on you right here. We have a promise that they that wait upon the Lord shall absolutely renew their strength. We wait for a moment, Lord. Not 2 hours like perhaps we should, but for a moment we wait on you. And we're waiting with faith and intentionality because we want the presence of the living God resting on us. Start to breathe in his presence by faith right now. Lord, I don't want to go home just having heard some good stirring messages. I want to go home with the touch of God that impacts every level of my being. Come and breathe upon me, Holy Spirit. Breathe upon me, Lord Jesus. Kingdom of God, come. And may the will of God be done. You see, receiving the Holy Spirit is an end unto itself. He is the first installment of heaven. He's the down payment on your inheritance. He's the introduction to the supernatural and the supernatural kingdom of God. He makes Jesus even more real. And through him, Jesus reveals the Father to us. Let that weighty presence fall upon your hands right here. Now by faith, breathe him in. The breath of God, the wind of God, the Spirit of God, breathe him in. Ah. Thank you, Jesus. Now turn to one or two people near you and lay those anointed hands on them and say, fire on you. May you be filled with the fiery, life-giving presence of the Holy Spirit in the mighty name of Jesus. Keep going, keep going. More, 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 more. Go for it. descend on us. We haven't come to be entertained. We haven't come just to hear good teaching. We've come to meet with you, O living God. And I lift heaviness off of you. I lift complacency off of you. And disappointment off of you. And I call you forth. I speak to your spirit. I call your spirit awake and to attention to receive what God has for you in this place right now. Come, wonderful Holy Spirit. Fill these people up with your fiery love. And those of you watching at home on video, etc., fire on you, the glory of God settling in this place, wave after wave of heaven coming. We take it, Lord. We breathe it in. We honor it. We absolutely honor the presence of the Holy Spirit. We don't want you in the back room. We don't want you in the basement. We're not embarrassed by you or ashamed of you. We love your fierce and glorious presence, Lord. Pour out upon us and shake us out of our complacency. And let us rise up as a mighty army of God, sons and daughters of the living God that know to take their cities and take their nation for the kingdom of heaven's sake. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. All right, you can take your seats. We just want to, wouldn't it be great to have an afternoon where the Holy Spirit took over? We've had those kind of meetings where you could never get it back. He just takes over and just goes from side to side and all around. Thank you, Lord.
Well, I just so feel that the Lord's saying that there's people here who, you were in the river, you were in this place of the glory, but somehow over the last few years or whatever, somehow you feel like you've slipped out. Where are you? I just feel like God is here. I want you to run up here really fast because I just feel God is here. He is saying that there is a download of this river anointing. Where you were in it, got out of it. I just want to bless. I'm just going to ask, oh my, okay, wow. It's always more than the hands. I'm just going to ask John to pray, but maybe you could just kneel down or lie down, because what I felt like God's saying is it's time to get back in the river of God, back into the river of life, back in that river, oh, that is flowing from the throne of God, the river of joy, the river of great joy, the river of great blessing. And even right now, to just say, Father, forgive me for any way I got out because of opinions of man, or I don't know, just out of complacency. I'm just going to ask John to pray, but I just feel like God's saying it's time to get back in the river of God and stay in the river of God. This is unto Jesus' return. This is unto his return. It's to never end. The flow of the Spirit, the flow of the river of God that is flowing here. From here to the ends of the world.
Oh, Lord. We are here because we're not satisfied. You have filled us with good things, but we're still hungry for more. Lord, you said if we would drink of you, the water that you give, we would never thirst again. So we thirst no more for other things, for the things of the world, but we are thirsty and hungry for more of you. Lord, our community needs you. Our city needs you. Our nation needs you. We have to have an outpouring of heaven continuously upon us. So as we wait before you and seek your face, God, have mercy on us. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon me now. Say this with me. Lord, I take it now. I receive it now. I drink deeply from that fountain of living water. Come and overwhelm me with your amazing presence. I love you and I want more. Ah, yes. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Give each one the desire of their heart, Lord. I pray that even while we're gathered, you will heal people of various, various things. In the name of Jesus. Someone has a stomach tumor right about right there. The Lord's touching it. Dead center almost. I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. Oh, Father. Burn tumors out of them. Just throw it in for good measure. Healed while we're here, thirsting and hungry for you. Oh, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. All right, well, don't come out of this zone, will you? Just stay in it. And while you're in it, I want to mention Patricia's book, Convergence, Heaven's Destiny, Becoming Your Reality. It's an amazing book here. Carol and I were one of the ones who endorsed it, mostly Carol, but Patricia and John have been a son and a daughter to us for many, many years. Back in 1990-something, 90 or 91, we married them in our Stratford church, and then they've been here with us, and then in Stratford, they took that over for 8 years. And then now they're back with us as our main campus pastors here at the airport campus, and we just love having them back in Toronto with us. And so let's give her a good welcome. I don't know how to do this. Maybe shout fire over her or something, you know, just be more appropriate. But here's her book. Go ahead and get a copy of that. And Patricia, you're burning. Go ahead.
Oh, keep coming, Holy Spirit. Oh, keep coming, keep coming. You know, the first night on Wednesday night, I had this really strange manifestation. My foot kept pushing down as if it was on an accelerator. And I just felt like God said he's accelerating things. He's accelerating things in our hearts this week. He's accelerating things in ministries and anointing. Oh, keep coming. Keep accelerating more, Lord. Oh, we love you. We just say, have your way, have your way. Let your word run swiftly this afternoon, God. Oh, let your glory continue to build and increase in this place. Encounters with you, with the living God. You know, I just have such a cry for lasting fruit, that we are changed by his glory. I love having a good time and I love a good meeting, but wow, to have lasting fruit. So Lord, we just thank you for lasting fruit. Thank you for change that remains. Thank you for encounters with you, God, that transcend anything. Whoa. Oh, that we've experienced more, more, more. You know, I was at Bethel once and, you know, I was just so longing for an encounter, and I was like, God, I gotta find somebody to pray for me. I gotta do something. Oh God, I need an encounter. I flew all this way. You know, I'm here because I want to meet with you. And you know, I just remember one time at lunch hour, when everybody else went to lunch, I was under a chair in Bethel and just bawling my eyes out as God encountered me, as I felt like, you know, my cry was heard. And you know, it wasn't when anybody was praying for me. It wasn't when their prayer lines were on. And I just feel like God's reminding me of that. You know, as we press in, we say, God, I want to encounter you. I want to be like that woman who went through the crowd and touched the hem of Jesus' garment. Hungry! Hungry for an encounter, oh God. I just want to bless hunger in the house. Hunger in us. Hungry for an encounter, Lord. We're hungry to meet with you, living God. Oh! So we will press in like that woman. We will say, God, here we are. Hungry, thirsty. Ho! Oh! Whoever's thirsty, come to the waters. Ho! Oh! Pay attention, that means ho! Oh! Whoever's thirsty, come and drink from the living water. Ho! Oh! Lord, we're thirsty, we're hungry. Thirsty, we're hungry. Come, breathe. Chantel, can you stand up for a second? I feel like I have a word for you. I just want to bless the anointing on your life. I just want to call forth. I felt like Isaiah 54 for you. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord. The righteousness is from me, says the Lord. And I just want to pray over you right now. I just saw you getting the sword. You know how Carol has such an anointing in this message of the sword of the Lord? But I felt like you are getting a sword. You're getting a new sword to cut strings and to cut ropes of injustice. To cut ropes and strings that have bound people and even bound nations. That God has given you a new authority, a new sword of authority to sever things that have held people back and have held nations back. And I feel like God's saying that this is for you, this passage of that. Even as you continue to do that, God is protecting you. You have a supernatural armor on you. You have a supernatural shield round about you. So I bless the warrior woman in you. I love it when I meet warrior women. God, I just bless this warrior woman, Lord. The Deborah, not afraid to go into battle. In Jesus' name, we just speak blessing right now over her. Fire of God. You know, I felt like there's somebody here that you've been wanting to have a baby or married, okay, but you've been wanting to have a baby and haven't, or maybe you've had one, but wanting another one. Who is that? Where are you? Because I really have faith for that. Come on up here. Even 2 weeks ago, somebody brought me this baby and said, this is the baby that you prayed would come. They had been trying for 7 years. And I have 6 kids, by the way, so if you want that many, I can pray for you. But even if you want one, okay, this is great, because I just really felt like the Lord stirring this and saying that, can I just have some of the team, second row intercessors, come on up here, and ministry team. Father, we just thank you right now in Jesus' name that you are going to give supernatural birth, supernatural conception here. Lord, there are children, there are babies, God, that you've appointed. Children like Isaac, Lord, nation changers, Lord, anointed babies. Father, we thank you for these babies, Lord. Even right now, make everything right, whatever needs to be right. In Jesus' name, we speak opening of the womb, opening of the uterus. We just speak openings right now. Fire of God flow. Fire of God flow. Thank you, Lord. Father, you see these cries. Lord, you see the tears. You see the cry. I just want to bless. I see supernatural conception. Well, I mean, not talking, not immaculate conceptions, okay? But you know what I'm talking about. Supernatural, God. Thank you, Lord, for where they've been told it's not going to happen. You know, medically speaking, we just say you are the higher realm of authority, Lord. You are the final say. In Jesus' name, we just speak right now. Blessing, blessing, blessing over wombs. Oh, fire. Take that right now. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. Right on this. Holy Spirit, come. Yay. More. More. Your glory, your presence. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Fire. 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 Whoa. More. More of your presence. Lord, just say yes. You know, I think maybe Joshua Mills touched on this, but I want to just reiterate. I really saw the Lord giving people writing, the gift of writing books, writing publishing. And yeah, just go ahead and stand if you know that's on your heart. And John, could I just say this to you too? I looked over at your worship and I saw Bill Johnson, and I know that you're friends, but I just want to bless the other fathers in the faith and apostles, but I want to bless that writing anointing, John. I feel like God's given you more books. Ho, ho, ho. These anointed books that are going where you can't go. Even more and more translation to other languages, John. I just bless the writing anointing on you. Father, I thank you for books here. Thank you for writing. God, I thank you that you are birthing the creative, the artistic, the just these ideas from heaven, Lord. Prophetic anointing. I heard it said that one writer talks about the writing angel. Lord, whatever it takes. Father, we just get the dust off the shelf and the dreams that are within. We get the dust off the shelf and the prophecies and the promises and say, we believe them. We take a hold of that. We take a hold of that. So just take a hold of that. Many of you, you've had prophecies about writing a book. You've had a word of the Lord about it. It's just, you know, the delay. I know what that's like, the delay thing. But Lord, I just thank you for the supernatural anointing to just do it. Do it. Get it out. Get it on the computer. Father, I thank you for that. Anointed writing, anointed publishing, books. Even some of them are novels, and some of them are for children and youth. Wave at me. You know yours is like children and youth. Yeah, that's right. Father, we just bless children's and youth books from a godly perspective, from godly angles. Thank you, Lord, for that. Even from this time, there's a marking. There's a marking of this writing anointing, of these prophecies getting off the shelf. Lord, pour it out, fire of God, more. Fire of God on you, Roxy. I just want to bless the writing anointing. Fire of God on her, fire of God. Lord, birth it in Jesus' name. Birth it in Jesus' name. Pour out your spirit. You know, I'm not going to ask this one to come forward, but I really feel like somebody here, you have a call to missions in a Muslim nation and some, you know, Muslim nations. And I just, you know who you are, but I just want to bless right now a fierce courage to just follow the cloud and the cloud by day, the fire by night. Not a presumption, but follow that cloud. I just want to bless what the Lord has been speaking to you, this missions thing, this missions anointing. And Father, increase it. Increase your fire. Increase. Can somebody just lay hands on, this is Roxy with the blonde hair. Fire of God on you, Roxy. There's something that God is birthing in you. Even in this time, in this season, the woman that has been sent out into the nations and the woman that has fierce courage to go where others wouldn't go, Father, put it on her. And even that writing angel, God, coming alongside of her, the publishing, the writing, birth it, Lord. Hey, birth what you want to birth in Jesus' name. Fire of God, fire of God, fire of God, fire of God. I do have this great message, really, but who also, this brother, I feel like you and there's more that have a call to go on the streets. Where are you, like evangelism in the streets? Can you just stand up as well? Father, I just want to bless those that are called to the streets to, in love. If you saw that Father Light's video on Tuesday, it was an awesome demonstration of seeing souls saved outside the walls of the church. Brother, I just want to bless that anointing on you for outside the walls of the church. God, fill them up, God, with the evangelistic anointing, the soul-winning anointing on them, God. Birth it more. Souls. Hey, a fierce courage, God. Fierce courage. Ha. Courage from heaven to do what he's called us to do. Many of you, you know it. Outside the walls, that's where most of the fish are. Outside the walls of the church. Ho. And he's calling us as fishers of man. Fishers of man. Hey. Fishers of man. Lord, pour it out. Birth this courage. You know, I woke up this morning with the strangest dream. I had this dream of the Wizard of Oz. Okay, anybody know what? I haven't seen that for like decades. But then as I was pondering this, what I felt like the Lord sang about it is, do you remember that movie? Anybody know what I'm talking about? The Wizard of Oz, you know, Dorothy and Kansas and Tornado. But there was three people that she met along the way. And if you remember, one of them was the Tin Man. What was Tin Man? He needed a brain, wasn't it? No, Scarecrow needed a brain. Scarecrow needed a brain. Tin Man needed a heart, thank you. And the Cowardly Lion needed courage. And this is my dream this morning, and I felt like God saying, now in that case, they were on their way, you know, to see the Wizard of Oz. But what I felt like God saying is that even today, that he's giving these things, I'm going to speak a message about the Word of God, the Spirit of God, in a culture of prayer. And I feel like he's giving brain, he's giving wisdom, he's giving a wisdom of the Word. How many need a brain in this place? Okay, wow, you need a brain. I need a brain. I need wisdom. Come on, he's going to give us wisdom. Wisdom from the Word. Wisdom that we've never had before. Ha, ha, ha. We're off to see the King of Kings on that yellow brick road. I believe he's pouring out courage. Courage. The lion needed courage. Whoa. We need courage, a fierceness, a courage to speak when he says to speak. Oh. To declare when he says to declare. Courage. God, I ask you to pour out courage right now. Yeah, the lion of the tribe of Judah is roaring. He's roaring. Years ago, just roaring and roaring for hours. I was hoarse. But I know when I got up off that carpet, I was changed. I had more courage than I had ever had before. God is pouring in courage today. Fierce determination. To go where he says to go, to say what he says to say, to do what he says to do. Courage! Courage from heaven. A supernatural courage. Whoa! I felt like insecurities had come off and something shifted in my brain. I was like, I don't care what people think anymore. I just want to obey God. I don't care what people think. You know, the fear of man. You know, I loved Duncan's sermon last night, but let's say bye-bye to the fear of man. How's that? Bye-bye, fear of man. Bye-bye, fear of man. Hello, obedience to God. Oh, courage, changing us to people of fierceness. I believe he's also giving us, as the tin man needed, a heart. Even as this afternoon from this stage, just a new level of passion. A new level of passion, oh God. More adoration for you. More passion for you, Lord. Increase our love. Increase the capacity with which we can love you, Lord. We need it. Oh, courage, wisdom, love. Increase it, Lord, we pray. We're off to see the King of Kings. We're off to see the King of Kings. We're on a yellow brick road this afternoon. We're off to see the King of Kings, to encounter him, the living God. He's the one who transforms us. Oh, woo. Keep coming, Holy Spirit. We love you. We long for you. Oh, I believe that there is, what the Lord is doing in the earth today is extraordinary. And I want to read a prophetic word that was given in 1947 by Smith Wigglesworth. Some of you may remember this. But I felt like the Lord just saying that this is so relevant for right now. Because I believe that he is bringing to the body of Christ such a marriage of the Word of God and the Spirit of God in a culture of prayer that takes us onto the sustained revival, the sustained reformation unto his return. This is what Smith Wigglesworth said. Very rare for him to prophesy. He wasn't known as a prophet. And he said this first part was that during the next few decades, there'll be two distinct moves of the Holy Spirit across the church in Great Britain. The first move will affect every church that's open to receive it, be characterized by a restoration of the baptism, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The second move of the Holy Spirit will result in people leaving historic churches and planting new churches. In the duration of each of these moves, the people who are involved will say, this is the great revival, but the Lord says, no, neither is the great revival. Both are steps towards it. Now, those of you from the UK, you can see that this has already happened. But listen to this part. When the new church phase is on the wane, there will be evidence in the churches, something that has not been seen before. A coming together of those with an emphasis on the Word and those with an emphasis on the Spirit. And when the Word and the Spirit come together, there will be the biggest move of the Holy Spirit that the nation, indeed the world, has ever seen. It will mark the beginning of a revival that eclipses anything that has been witnessed within these shores, even the Wesleyan, the Welsh revivals. The outpouring of God's Spirit will flow up from the UK to the mainland of Europe. From there will begin a missionary move to the ends of the earth. Come on, let's all take that. Whatever nation you're from. The Word and the Spirit. In a culture of prayer, believe that God is marrying us as people of the Word. Ha! Huh. What did Jesus say? That in the last days there will be many deceived, there will be many false prophets, there will be much deception. I believe that God is saying, as God's people, there's an increased hunger he wants to put in us for the Word of God, for the Word of God, to love the Word, to love His Word. You know, can I just say that I believe that we really need a real move of this? By the way, how many know what year it is in the Jewish calendar? 5773, as of just on Sunday evening, Monday, right? Rosh Hashanah. Now the Day of Atonement coming. 5773, 73, every one of the numbers in the Hebrew has a letter, right? And 73 is, let me get it right here, is En Gimel, which is, En is the symbol of sight, the symbol of sight and insight. And you know, I believe that God is pouring out a new level of prophetic revelation, of insight, of wisdom, that this is a year of great insight in the things of the Spirit, in the things of the Word, leading us to a harvest. And you know, just the other night, I was just sitting on my bed, reading my Bible, but kind of mind my own business, and I so felt the Lord come upon me in such a thick way. And I just felt Him saying, very simply, He said, my return is nearer than you think. It's nearer than you think. You know, I actually think that I think it's pretty close. You know, I think that I thought I had a pretty good grip of I want to get ready. I'm trying to get ready. And God, I want to be ready. But He said, my return is nearer than you think. And then He also said this. He said, the greatest harvest. Now, I submit this. This is a prophetic word. He said, the greatest harvest the world's ever seen is coming in 2015. Felt like I'm saying, you're going to see so many souls saved in 2015. You've never seen anything like it. That's like not far away. Have you noticed that? But I just felt like, I'm not saying He's coming in 2015. What I'm saying is I felt like Him saying there's such an increase of evangelism now and even unto that year. But I just really felt like Him saying, my return is near. It's urgent. It's an urgent hour. Wake up. Wake up. He was saying it to me. I believe He's saying it to us. Wake up. The hour is urgent. His return is so imminent. It's so soon. I want to be ready. I want to be living ready, perpetually ready, always ready. Huh. I want to know His Word. I want to know His Spirit. And I want to be found in this place of prayer. I want to give you some statistics, not to depress you, but just to give you some insight into reality. Oh. Do you know the U.S. debt, God bless the Americans, I don't know the Canadian debt, that's why I'm quoting yours, but in the first 211 years of the U.S. history, the nation of the U.S. incurred $3.4 trillion debt. And then by the end of 2000, it was 5.8. But in the year of 2011, it went to 15 trillion. That's with a T. Trillion. That's mind-boggling. That's a lot of money. And I also, you know, how many of you maybe, has anybody in America seen 2016, that movie? I was just in Florida last week, so I went to see that movie. That's quite eye-opening, by the way. I think you should go see it if you're an American. I'm a Canadian, but I pray for your country. Do you know that we pray in the house of prayer? We're praying every Tuesday, second hour set for your election. That God would come and God would lead you and bless your nation. As far as abortions worldwide, there's 42 million every year. There's 115,000 every day. Every day. In unwed mothers, it's blossomed or boomed to 47% of births are from unwed mothers. And then we can look at the nations gathering. Psalm 2, I believe, is such a strategic chapter. I just want you to have an idea of the fact that God is on the move. But I tell you, there's so many fulfillment of prophecies going on right now. Psalm 2, actually turn there for a minute. You know, the nations that are gathering against Israel, just in the last few years, think about it. Peace treaties that are now, you know, not, they don't mean anything anymore. Nations that were okay or at least semi-peaceful with Israel are becoming harsher and harsher as the nations are raging. In Psalm 2, it was Charles Spurgeon who first said that Psalm 2 is the divine end time drama in four different acts, each with three verses. Now think about that. Charles Spurgeon said that. This is a divine end time drama, Psalm 2. Now look at that. The first three verses, Act 1. It's the kings of the earth as they raise their fists to God. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, saying, his anointed, saying, let us break their bonds in pieces and cast their cords from us. Do you think maybe it looks like that there's many nations that are gathering against Israel or gathering against the Lord's anointed or even just gathering against the Lord? Who is the Lord? Raising their fists. It's happening. We're seeing it unfolding. We're seeing these gatherings of the nations already. It goes on. The next act is the Father in heaven. He sits in the heavens and laughs. Don't you think that's just awesome? He sits in that. Isn't it awesome that God is not wringing his hands? Oh no, they're gathering against Israel. Oh no, they're defying me. He sits in the heavens and laughs. Wow. That's why we can laugh. That's why we can have freedom and we can have peace in the midst of whatever is going on. The third act is Jesus' intercession. And verses 7 till 9, Jesus, I will declare the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. I have begotten you. Ask of me and I will give you the nations. I will give you the nations. It's your inheritance. It's your possession. Oh! And the last one is King David himself speaking and saying, therefore be wise, O kings. Be instructed, you judges. Serve the Lord with fear and trembling. Rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son. Kiss the Son. Oh, we need more of what we were doing this afternoon. Let's just kiss the Son. Let's just love up on him. This is the safest place to be, is in the center of his will, in intimacy with him, loving him. There's an unfolding. There is a drama that is happening in the earth today. And I tell you something. God is calling us to arise as peoples that, you know, this is one of my prayers. Lord, give me the nations as my inheritance. I want to stand with you, Jesus, and say, give us the nation. Give us the nation of Canada as your inheritance, Lord. I tell you, we are pressing in for this nation to fulfill its destiny and its calling to be this end time nation that arises in leadership for the things of God. Where's a Canadian? Somebody say hallelujah. You know, I love where we've been going in the last few years and we want more. And those of you, maybe you heard, but are you know, we're just grateful for what the Lord is doing in Canada, in our government and in our parliament and in our nation, the blessings abounding. I remember July 22nd, you know, we had a prayer set here from this stage and we were crying for the ending of the drought. You know, that there was drought in Canada too. One of my brothers, a farmer, was saying that there was a lot of, you know, his crops were struggling. So on July 22nd, we gathered as a house of prayer team. And we were crying out. Do you know, before we even opened our mouths, it was hilarious. The set was to begin at 7. At like 6:45, it was torrential rain. We're like, hey, God, we haven't even started yet. Do you know that it has rained since that time? And we've been blessed. Now, I just feel like God is saying that, you know, there's this thing of where if my people call by my name will humble themselves and pray. It's not there for just good measure. So I feel like God is saying there's an end time drama that's unfolding. But our prayers make a difference in us taking our place in him. Psalm 2, this great end time drama. The word and the spirit. You know, my grandfather on my mother's side was a man of the word. I called him Opa. And he, when I would visit, I would see these like stacks and literally huge books and commentaries and concordances and different versions of the Bible. And wow, my image of him was him sitting in his lazy boy chair reading the Bible. That was my image of my grandpa. And you know what? The thing was, is I never really like knew him very well because he actually wasn't even that nice. He wasn't necessarily all that friendly or anything, or because he, to my knowledge, I don't know that he ever really knew the Spirit. He loved the Word, and I appreciate that. I honor him for that. He's gone on to glory. But then, you know, I've known prophetic people who, you know, they love the Spirit and they love prophecy, but, you know, I remember one guy saying to me one time, he said, you know, I just heard this in an incredible encounter. I heard the trumpets blowing, And I'm telling you, I believe that all the seven trumpets in the book of Revelation have already blown. And I was looking at him thinking, you know what? If that's true, we're in trouble, because of the seventh trumpet is when Jesus comes again. So if we're here and all the trumpets have blown, there's something crazy. Just see how we need the Word and we need the Spirit. I love that saying that said, if you have the Word without the Spirit, you dry up. If you have the Spirit without your Word, you what? You blow up. But if you have the Word and the Spirit, we can grow up. I believe that God is saying, he's encountering us today to be lovers of the Word and lovers of the Spirit in a culture of prayer, that he's gripping us, even as leaders here today, to be having a new level of commitment to the Word of God and to the Spirit of God and to this pursuit. Oh, the pursuit of the more, the urgency of the hour. Oh, Lord, take us deeper. Take us deeper. I want to talk a little bit about, again, a couple statistics of pastors. I'm going to pick on pastors. Where's our pastors here and leaders and awesome? Hey. Thank you, Jesus, for the pastors and leaders. But listen to these statistics. This is from Lifeline for Pastors. 80% of pastors spend less than 15 minutes a day in prayer. 70% of pastors surveyed say the only time they spend in studying the Word is when they're preparing for sermons. 1,500 pastors leave the ministry each month due to moral failure, spiritual burnout, or contention in their churches. 50% of pastors' marriages end in divorce. 95% do not regularly pray with their spouses. 80% of seminary and Bible school graduates who enter the ministry will leave the ministry within the first 5 years. And I thought I'd put this in here, depending on who's listening, but 70% of pastors feel grossly underpaid. Okay. Oh, actually, that's kind of sad. It's kind of sad. 15 minutes a day. Oh, I just feel like there's a challenge going out that God is gripping our hearts today. He's gripping our hearts for the more. He's gripping our hearts and for the pressing in. Oh, going after the Word. Going after His Spirit in this culture of prayer. Oh, to love what He loves, to hate what He hates. His Joel Rosenberg quotes this guy named Gypsy Smith, who says this. He would say, do you want to see revival? He said, then go home and draw a circle around yourself. And then pray, get on your knees and pray for the conversion and for the personal revival of everybody within that circle. And then you're going to start to see revival. We need a personal revival. We need fire right here to start fire out there. A fire within, a fire that burns all of us. Jeremiah is saying, the Word of God is like a fire in my bones. I can't hold it back. Have to prophesy. Oh, set us on fire, Lord. Give us a personal revival that leads to revival wherever we go. Jesus said the Word. He quoted the Word, Matthew 4:4. He's tempted by the devil three times, as we know. He gives scripture each time. And I love what he says in Matthew 4:4. Quoting from Deuteronomy 8, he said, man cannot live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Now that is actually technically rhema, if you look at it in the Greek, which is the spoken word of God. But the logos, the written word, the spoken word, we need the Word of God to grow up as our daily bread, a hunger for His words that come to us in the still small voice, a hunger to hear and listen for His life-giving words, a hunger for this Word. You know, my daughter is in Kansas City in the IHOP U's University. And one of her favorite courses so far has been a course on a biblical worldview. And she was just sharing her notes with me, and I was fascinated as well about how our worldview so affects the way that we believe and the things that we process cognitively. And so much of our worldview has been shaped by the philosophers such as Socrates, and then after him was Plato, and after him was Aristotle. Aristotle was a tutor to Alexander the Great, who went and conquered much land and set up Hellenistic, you know, centers of thinking, you know, Greek philosophy, which has permeated a lot of the church through a guy by the name of Origen years ago. Origen was coupling or marrying this Greek philosophy with the teachings of the scripture. And believe it or not, we have been all, you know, subject to that in some way. And the philosophy has a lot to do with reasoning. You know, if you can't see it, or you can't, if it's not tangible, or it's not, you know, intellectually graspable, then it really isn't that important. So heaven and hell and God lost a lot of their significance, or even the fear of God, because of these teachings. Now, it's interesting, because when I was in the National House of Prayer in Ottawa, they said the same thing. They said that what they teach their interns, the first course they teach them, is a biblical worldview. Because they say they're sending them into Parliament, and they need to understand where so many of these politicians are coming from, a training of a worldview of these philosophies, and that affects the way they make decisions. It affects the way that they think, and affects laws and government in the land. You know, we need to get back to a biblical worldview. A worldview that says, I believe the Bible. I believe God created the Bible. I was on the airplane on Thursday with a guy sitting next to me. I was flying back from the States, and I felt like the Lord said, you're going to talk to this guy. And I'm like, okay, God, what am I going to say? How many know you when you're on an airplane, you just want to kind of, you know, mind your own business and read your book? Anyways, God just kind of unfolded it, and I began to talk with this man who was a businessman, a really high-up business guy who oversees, or he manages or owns a whole chain of grocery stores. But I was sharing with him and saying, you know, the Bible, I believe it's true. And I was showing him the Romans road and saying, you know, when Jesus said that he's the only way, the truth, and life, he's the only way in truth and life. And I believe that, you know, we flip to Genesis. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God, he was there. He's uncreated, this uncreated, incredible God. I believe it. I believe it. I'll stake my life on this. I know it because I know him in a personal way. This guy was so fascinated, you know, and he wanted me to pray for him. I was praying for him, and his tears were coming, and he sent me an email later, and he said, wow, you know, I was so happy I met you at 35,000 feet in the air. I've never had an experience like that in my life. And, you know, he was meeting with Jason Kenney the next day. You know, this guy, I just said, God, get the thinkers of our country. Get the businessmen, oh Lord, to see that your word is true. You are true. That's what God is doing, these seven mountains of influence to show us the reality. But you know what? We need to know his word. We need to know what he says is true, what the word is true. Oh, the importance of a biblical worldview. And I believe that God is also taking us into, you know, as moms and dads, and just loving up and on our children. What does Joshua 1:8 says? Listen to this. The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you have good success. Meditate on the word of God. Let it, what does that word meditate mean? In the Hebrew, it means this, to ponder out loud to oneself. That's why the Jews at the Wailing Wall, what are they doing? They're like this at the Wailing Wall, right? What is that? They're meditating, they're speaking out loud the words of God, the Torah and the scriptures that they've learned. They're pondering, they're meditating on. But I feel like God is calling us even to be people that, you know, somehow I call them prophetic decrees, but every day I'll declare things like, you know, I'm the head and not the tail. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. It's no longer I who live, it's Christ who lives in me. I want to remind myself of who I am. I want to remind myself of the truth of who I am in him. Meditating on the word. And getting it not only in us, but I just want to encourage parents here today, is about getting the word of God into our children, to, you know, to bring it to this next generation, a love for the word, an honor for the word of God. And so, you know, John and I, we've sought to cultivate that in our children, and we read the Bible at the breakfast table and at the dinner table twice a day. At the table, as well as, you know, they have their own Bible times. But I tell you, it's done something. Even as we're reading this children's Bible, that's really accurate to scripture. But it's incredible, because I just feel like we're all learning. You know, even some of the details of the scripture and the truth of the word, saying this is for us to live by. A love for the word. Do you love the word today? I just feel like God wants to impart a new love for the word. And I know what it's like to have times where it's dry. It's like, oh God, does this make any sense? And I've cried out, you know, I said, Lord, give me a love for your word. Give me understanding. Holy Spirit, you say that you teach us. Teach me what this is saying. And now, honestly, I can say that I just love to read the word of God. I think it's better than any novel. I like to read books. Better than any book, any novel, just to read the word of God. And I'm in the Old Testament, New Testament, but to teach it to our children. Jesus said this in John 5. He said, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have life, but you're not willing to come to me that you may have life. So he's calling us, you and I, to come to him through the word. Lord, show me and ignite this word in my heart. Let a fire be in my bones as I read and meditate and devour. I want to come to the living word through the written word. I don't want to just read it as words in a page. I want to come to you. I want to meet with you in this encounter. You know, and I just want to encourage times where you set aside, where we set aside love for the word. Listen to what Psalm 19 says. Obviously, this the longest chapter in the Bible. So much about the word of God. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Let me not wander from your commandments. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I may not sin against you. Verse 37, turn away from my eyes from looking at worthless things and revive me in your way. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Your faithfulness endures to all generations. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Verse 147, I rise before the dawning of the morning. I cry for help. I hope in your word. My eyes are awake throughout the night watches that I may meditate on your word. Verse 160, the entirety of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever. Come on. Oh, put it in us, God. A love for your word, to teach it to our children, to honor your word, to love, to meditate, and to get things out of your word that we've never, you know, seen before or gotten before. John, my husband, just got a new program called Accordance for his Bible study. That's, you know, at a click of a button, you get all these, you know, the Hebrew, the Greek, the everything in the Bible. But sometimes we need to invest in whatever it takes to invest in a good study Bible or some commentaries. And, you know, I was studying Daniel a while ago, and Daniel, did you know that Daniel 11 is the most prophetically accurate chapter in the whole Bible? It is just incredibly prophetically accurate. Historically, so much of it has already been, has already happened. And, you know, as I began to read it, but then read it also with commentaries, I thought my eyes were enlightened. It actually, you know, doesn't name him, but Alexander the Great is in Daniel 11, prophesies about this leader, and prophesies about all these things that were to come. And how many of you know the rest of the Daniel prophecies are going to come to pass? You know, exactly as he said, the 300 prophecies in the Bible that pointed to Jesus' first return all came to pass to a T. And all the other prophecies about his second return are going to come to pass to a T. And you and I are to know them. You know, I loved what Lance Wolno said one time. He talked about a true story from 9/11. And it was that these businessmen were in the 23rd floor of the second tower when the plane struck, and they couldn't open the elevator. And so they're on their cell phones and trying to get help. You know, somebody get up here. What's going on? What's happening? Obviously, there's confusion. There's mayhem. And they can't get the elevator door open. And there's dust everywhere. But there was a custodian who had his mop with him, his broom, his mop. And he knew how to, you know, he knew the building inside out. But what he did was he pried open the elevator door, and he saw debris from the floor down, the men's washroom from the floor below them. And so as the businessmen, again, you know, their $1,000 suits and their, you know, their briefcases, and they're trying to get on their cell phones again. This guy, he takes his mop apart with the end, the steel part of his mop. He bores a hole in the drywall, sheetrock, the Americans call it, and gets a big enough area to get these guys through. He grabs these businessmen and says, follow me. and he takes them through that hole into the men's washroom on the floor below. There he knows where he's going. He takes them through the stairs, and they exit the building just in time as it collapsed. True story from 9/11. And you know, the truth is that you and I are to be, the body of Jesus Christ, are to be like that window washer guy. When stuff is coming down, and it is coming down, when things are happening in the world, when the shaking that's happening, that we are the ones that say, hey, the Word of God is saying this and this, and you know, this is what's going to happen, and Jesus is coming, and get ready, and this is the way, and I can help you see the way. That's our position. It's our honor to know the truth, to know what is coming down. You know, back in May, I was looking back my journaling. I really encourage journaling. I encourage writing out with the things that God has told you. And I look back sometimes and I'm like, wow, you know, what he said way back then makes sense now. It didn't really make sense back then. But I was looking back at my journaling and seeing May 14th when he was telling me, I felt like God saying, it's a little bit like the eye of the storm in the Middle East and in the world right now. He said, because everything was kind of calm in May. And he said, but riots are gonna come again, and there's gonna be more government discontent and coming against governments, and it's riots are gonna break out again. It's almost like you're in the calm right now. And so now I'm looking at what's been happening even the last couple weeks. I'm thinking, wow, that makes total sense. And again, what he was saying, he was just calling this, the urgency of the hour, the urgency of preparation. And I believe also this place of prayer, as I'm going to get into in a minute, about the place of prayer. But let's talk about the Spirit. I just love, you know, John and Carol, their love for the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to be under their leadership as they press into the things of the Spirit. Press in for signs and wonders. I just want to honor them. You know, they paid a price, but have stayed true in integrity and righteousness and holiness. And can we just honor them for a minute? Such a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for remaining righteous and humble. And thank you for just standing in morality. And wow. But I love the way they press into the presence. And, you know, I read this book just recently. Really, just, you know, you read a book and it just wrecks you. I just read Catherine Coleman's book, God Can Do It Again. And where's that lady that was in Catherine Coleman's choir? There you are. Stand up for us to see you. She was in Catherine Coleman's choir back in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Woo-hoo! Come on. Saw a lot of awesome things in her day. But Catherine Coleman, these stories were phenomenal. You know, just like medically written off, gonna die, you know, no hope. And they would come to a meeting and get radically healed. And I was just like, oh, God, we want to see more. You know, these signs and wonders. And I was just so gripped by it. And, you know, one of the things that she mentions in this book, it sounded so simple, but it really affected me, where she said that faith is kind of like learning to float in water. You know, that you got to come to the point where you stop flailing and stop, like, you know, fighting and trying to try. And you just got to rest and kind of relax in that water. And then you learn to float. You learn to float in the water. She says, faith is kind of like that, where you learn to know that you can't make it happen. She was the first to say, I am not a healer. She would say, I am, it's not me. It is totally all him. And how do you learn to just kind of float in this faith walk and say, whoa, I'm just going to trust you, Lord. I'm going to trust you. So we learn to, you know, take a step back into his presence, say, come through for me, Holy Spirit. Oh, Holy Spirit, come and touch and heal. And, you know, I want to do my part, but, you know, we can't do his part. And on Wednesday night, I just had this thing, this vision where I'm in this river, and I felt like I'm floating in this river, and I'm just really experiencing this. And Lord's saying, you know, once again, I felt like I'm saying that we're to get in the river again. Come on. We're to float in the river of life. The river that is flowing from the throne of God, where it's him who carries us. It's his power. It's his presence who takes us places in him. In the river, Ezekiel's river talks about, in the river is many fish, and in the river, everywhere the river goes, there is life. Life. Now, I had a dream a couple months back, and in the dream, actually, I was asking the Lord to speak to me, and he said, I'm going to speak to you in a dream. So I'm like, okay, I better have a nap, which I did. But I had this dream, and in the dream, I'm trying to drive with my left hand, and for some reason my right hand, I couldn't use it in the dream. And all of a sudden, all these cars around me were, you know, they're having trouble, they're fishtailing, and I'm trying to navigate these cars with one hand, and I'm crying out to God in the dream, God, help me, what's going on, I need my arm, and what? And I woke up, and I was like, what was that? You said you'd give me a dream? That was like really weird. And what I felt like I'm saying is this, he said, you've learned to depend still on your own strength, and you need to need the Holy Spirit more than you do. You need to really, really want the Holy Spirit more than you do. Ugh, I felt so convicted. I was like, God, you know, if we ever come to this place of where we're satisfied with what we've seen, and praise God, in this house we've seen a lot. But let us never be satisfied in what we have seen or experienced or saying, I've eaten, I wipe my mouth and say I had enough. No way. Let's press in for the more. So I'm crying out and I'm saying, God, I want you. I want you, Holy Spirit, forgive me for any way that I've been satisfied with this level. You know, and you come to this degree and, oh, Lord, I know there's so much more out there and I really want to press in for more. And so, you know what he did, even that night, I was in Sweden, actually, I shared my dream, and it was incredible. There's this massive repentance in this really theological church that they had a lot of teachers in the university, it was really mostly all university students, and they all just wept before the Lord, said, we're sorry, Holy Spirit, where we have intellectualized you out of the picture, and where we have not depended on you. Do you know the Holy Spirit came in such power? By the end of the night, we were all rolling on the floor and laughing hysterically, and the Holy Spirit came. They had to carry them out, I heard, at 1 and 2 o'clock in the morning. I think we need to get hungry again. What do you think? More of the Spirit. We need you, Holy Spirit. We want you. Oh, let's just even now. Holy Spirit, forgive us. Forgive us, Holy Spirit, for any way that we have said we've had enough, or we've liked the level we're at, or where we haven't really wanted or prayed for or pressed in for more. Holy Spirit, forgive us. We ask that you would wash away complacency, that you would wash away every bit of where we've said that we've had enough. Oh God, oh, hungry, hey, hungry for more of the Spirit, hungry for more of your glory, of your presence, of miracles, signs and wonders. Oh, I just, you know, leaders here, I know what it's like. It's sometimes you think, oh, it's so much easier to just go on with the preaching, you know, forget the praying for the sick stuff, because what if he doesn't show up? God is saying, step out on the water. Risk. I will come through. Oh, get out of that boat where it's safe. Get out of that boat. Oh. Well, something Majid said really stuck with my husband and I when he said that there's the Christians, so many in the comfort zone, and then there's the one in the conflict zone. We got to get out of our comfort zone and enter into more of the conflict, where we're pressing in for the more, even for the freedom of others, but we're also just saying, God, I want to dare to believe for the miraculous. I want to dare to believe, Holy Spirit, that you will show up, and we pray for the sick, and we press in for the more. Press in for the more. Oh God, come. My own daughter just a few weeks ago, not long ago, a month ago, was diagnosed with a lump on her thyroids, my 19-year-old daughter. And I tell you, I fought to get out of fear into faith. I'm like, what? God, like this, you know, ultrasound showed big thing. You know, they had the measurements. We could actually palpate it, feel it. And she had been kind of lacking energy, and her thyroid production was not right. And I was like, ah, when it touches home, like, it's like all of a sudden, okay, God, we're pressing in for more. But I was really fighting to get out of faith into fear. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know, when it's you, when it's your kid, it's like, I know that God is, I know, I've seen him heal, but Lord, do it again. Do it here. Do it in my kid, God. I remember crying out for the Lord to come and heal her. And just, you know, I distinctly remember when I felt like I crossed the line from fear into faith. It was like all of a sudden, it's like I just felt the fear lift, and I was like, I know that I know that I know what I believe. I know that I know what I believe. You know, they overcame them by what? The blood of the Lamb, the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives unto death. Do you think maybe that was fear that lifts off them too? So anyway, so this was awesome, and we had prayer. Carol prayed for her and John, and we had so the House of Prayer team fasted, and I just honor them and thank them. But you know, when we went for the biopsy, and they bumped up the biopsy so she could get back to university. But anyway, so hoping she could get back to university, we were told, no, she's probably going to have to stay. She can't go back to the U.S. She's going to have to have this and this and this. And one doctor said, we're going to have to take out the entire thyroid. And we're like, ah! Anyways, we went for the biopsy. They had to do the ultrasound to find, to do the biopsy. They couldn't find anything. Come on. I was like, wow, God. And we went for another ultrasound just to confirm, and sure enough, it was completely gone. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Our God is a God who, I'm still in email contact with a 21-year-old guy who came here a few months ago. He was told by his doctors in Belgium that he was dying. He's 21, dying from cancer. And, his one guy said to him, you should think about getting on an airplane, go to either Bethel or Toronto, and just pray that God will heal you, because there's no other hope for you. This 21-year-old young man comes here to Toronto. I'll never forget. His name is Benjamin. Tall, lanky guy from Belgium. And we were praying for him. And every time I kept saying, come to the house of prayer. We soaked in the house of prayer and prayed for him. Do you know that he went home to Belgium? And I actually didn't know at first until I arrived in Belgium a month ago or so, 2 months ago. I was in Belgium. First thing they said to me when I got off the plane, he's healed. He's completely healed. Wow. I was like, thank you, God. I saw him. He's still in email contact with me. He said, he went to this youth conference, this youth event that's once a year. And last year when he's at the youth event, he kept thinking, this is my last year at this youth event, because they'd given him like, a month to live or something. And he said when he was back at that youth event this summer, and they were all looking at him, the people hadn't seen him, and they're like, you're here. He said, I'm here, and I'm healed. Ah, come on. God, more. We need the Spirit. Spending time in the secret place. Spending time. I just want to remind us of the soaking. It happens great at a conference, but do it at home. Do it at home. You're not at a conference every day. Put on that anointed music. Just soak. Be before you do. Something I learned years ago is how if I put on that music in the morning and just soaked, I got up and I was so much happier that day, and so much, just filled with the fruit of the Spirit. We need the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. My address for 8 years was 40 Eagle Drive. I was like, okay, God, I get it. Isaiah 40, 31 says, what? They that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength, mount up with wings as eagles, run and not grow weary, walk and not faint. And then my address was Victor Avenue, so I get that too, God. Okay, into victory. Now my address is River Grove. And you know what Grove means? Grove means a fruitful orchard, a place of great fruitfulness. If we stay in the river, we go into great fruitfulness. Somebody say amen. Bless you. Come on, Lord, take us into fruitfulness. Lord, we want to soak in your presence. Are we abiding? It builds up our spirit. Spend time working on building your spirit. How many of you have been at Caesarea in Israel? Do you remember Caesarea? It's by the Mediterranean. I remember them telling us that Paul was in prison there, and he could see the runners, the track. It's still there. The Olympians and the training of the athletes. And that's what he's, when he talks about the training of the physical body is of a temporal benefit, but what? But the building up of the spirit is for eternal. How much more so should we be building our spirit than our bodies? And I'm not saying forget your exercise. Your exercise is good. Go exercise. I exercise. But the building up of our spirit, spend time building your spirit. Spend time with the Spirit. Soaking in his presence, being with him. I want to know you. I want to know you. I love Ephesians 3, Philippians 3, basically kind of say the same thing, but Paul talks about the preach among the Gentiles, the unsearchable riches of Christ. And he says this in Philippians 3, he talks about, I count everything else as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, that I may gain, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection, that I press on to lay hold of that which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. I press towards the goal for the prize of the upward call. I press on. I press in. Think about those athletes training and training and getting up early and, you know, they count it as a joy because they like to do it. How about much more so should we build up our spirit onto eternal value? I press on to lay hold of the prize of the upward call in Christ Jesus. And I want to talk about this place of prayer. How many are sensing God increasing your prayer life? Come on, talk to me. Yeah, I figured as much. Do you think maybe he's doing that? He's increasing prayer. David Youngie Cho says this, a prayerless church is a powerless church. He's calling us, as Isaiah 56:7 says, my house should be called a house of prayer. He's calling us into a sustained place of prayer, a corporate place of prayer. Look in the book of Acts. Almost every chapter is about a prayer meeting, about coming together, one accord. We talked about our private prayer, your time with God, but there's a corporate call that he's bringing us into a sustained place of prayer. The prayer movement that is coming to the earth, it's already here, but it is building and gaining momentum. I keep getting invitations to go and help and, you know, bless this house of prayer, that house of prayer. There's house of prayer leaders here who have come up to me. I just want to bless you because, you know, the whole thing of prayer, I remember years ago getting all those prophecies about being prophetic, and I'm like, yee, woo! And then get all these prophecies about being a person of prayer, and I'm like, oh, intercession. It sounded so boring. I was like, God, are you sure? Like, I like the prophetic part. And the Lord showed me to go hand in hand. And then you know what else he showed me? He showed me the joy of prayer. Come on. He showed me the joy of coming into his presence. Because first and foremost, it's about intimacy. First and foremost, it's about a love affair. It's about, I come to meet with you, the living God. I come to meet with you and love you. I come to glorify you. What is worship? Worship is agreeing with who he is. I agree with you, King of the universe. I agree with you, your majesty, your glory. I worship you. And then I intercede. We intercede agreeing with what he wants to do. What does he want to do? I agree with that too. I remember one time in our house of prayer, we started a place of prayer in Stratford. And I remember one time, it was like, it's so much better here, by the way, in terms of we have phenomenal singers and musicians. These guys, a lot of them, they volunteer. They're here from, you know, Australia, they're here from England, they're here from Germany, just to come and build the house of prayer in Toronto. Hallelujah. But you know, I remember in Stratford, and I felt like it was a little bit of a semi-pathetic set, but the heavens were opened for an instant, and I saw Jesus with my eyes. And I saw him, and he was looking from this place of heavenly realms at our little pathetic house of prayer with such joy. And he was smiling, and he was like, I just saw him for a moment, calling the angels, saying, look at how they worship me. And I felt his pleasure. And then it just, you know, it was like just for an instant, then it closed and I was like, but I was wrecked. I was like, you really like it that much? Wow. Okay, fueled us to do it more. Do you know that what we have seen is God just, he comes. He just comes. He comes. If we want more of his presence, I want to encourage you to have sustained worship and prayer. Have a place of prioritizing. As Amos 9:11 said, in the last days I'm rebuilding the tabernacle of David. What was the tabernacle of David? Can I have the team come back up, by the way? David puts 4,000 Levites, their full-time job is to simply play music to the Lord. That's their job. He puts 280 prophetic singers, that's their job, to prophesy in song before the Lord. He puts $1 billion into the work of the house of the Lord. He funds singers and musicians to play. And in this case, he played 24/7 for about 40 years, coinciding with Israel's greatest boundaries in history, greatest time of blessing. This is called the Tabernacle of David. And then many times in the Old Testament, when the Israelites had gotten away from God's purposes, There was revivals in the Old Testament, such as Jehoshaphat and Hezekiah and Josiah and Jedidiah, Ezra and Nehemiah. Each of them were instructed to do what? To put the singers back in place. To get the singers and to get the musicians back into the place in the house of the Lord of sustained worship and prayer. I tell you something, I am so convinced of this, I will, for the rest of my life, help build houses of prayer. Because I know that God is rebuilding the tabernacle of David in the spirit, in the values, and the principles of the tabernacle of David until Jesus' return. David cries out in Psalm 2, oh God, I need a habitation of your glory. And then he establishes it, and the Lord responds to him. You can look it up, and he says, there I will make the horn of the government of David grow. There I prepared a place for my Messiah, my anointed one. There's a bride that's getting ready. It's a praying bride. It's a victorious bride. It's a bride fierce in courage. Oh, and there's a fueling of this word and the spirit in a culture of prayer. It's like a beautiful cocktail. It's like a beautiful mixture. Oh, taking us into the places that he wants us to go. Transforming churches and ministries. Transforming nations. Hallelujah for our National House of Prayer in Ottawa. Every time our government is in session, somebody from the National House of Prayer is praying in our parliament buildings, and we have seen a turnaround. Hallelujah! Something like 40% of members of parliament are Christians, and our prime minister is a Christian. In Norway, they started a house of prayer every morning, praying for an hour. They've seen such a turnaround. On and on, I could tell you stories of where God is moving, and even historically, Bangor, Ireland, had 300 years of worship and intercession. They sent out missionaries from there into Europe, planting churches, planting, you know, education, and on and on and on. The Moravians, who were really the missionaries sent out, they came from 120 years of prayer. God is breathing on his church. It's time to press in. It's time for a sustained level of prayer and worship, such as it was in David's day. We can learn from David, the man after God's own heart, the man who knew how to be a priest, and he knew how to be a king. And Ezekiel 44 talks about our priestly duty, and we are the priests of the Lord, and it's this. Jesus talked about the priests who didn't do what they were supposed to do. He calls them an abomination. But the priest who, you can look it up, Ezekiel 44, stand before me, keep my charge, minister to me, draw near to me. As he talked about the priest's duty. And then they were to go into the outer courts and minister to the people. You have a job. I have a job. I have 6 kids. I homeschool. I travel. And yeah, I know what it means to be busy. But I tell you something. God's taught me how to be a priest. He's taught me that first, if I will stand before him, if I will minister to him, if I will keep his charge, everything else he blesses. Everything else he takes care of. Everything else he adds on to. I want to be a priest that keeps the charge of the Lord to stand before him. Yes, in our closets, but I believe that God is putting a call out there for the corporate gathering, the one accord, where we come together in unity. The commanded blessing on the heels of unity. There's something about that place of one accord. Like in the upper room, the Holy Spirit came. Shook the whole place, the wind, the fire, the wine. Hey! He's coming soon. He's coming soon. The praying church, the bride in love. Let's all stand together. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. Let's get ready. He's coming. Let's be people of the Word. He's coming. Let's be people of the Spirit. He's coming. Let's be people of prayer. Yes, Lord. You know what I felt this afternoon is that he was just going to come on us, even as we worshiped and prayed here for the last bit that we have, about half an hour, just to worship him and pray. And it's not so much about who lays hands on you right now. It's about you encountering him. But can we just cry out to him? Lord, we just say yes. We say yes to be people of your word. Yes. I believe that the Lord is giving a hunger for the Word of God in here. A hunger and a real sense of connecting with the Word in a new way, where what we read comes alive with the Spirit breathing on our Bible study times. I just want to pray right now, connecting with the Spirit in a new way. Take us deeper, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we love you. We need you. We want you. We say more. More of you. More of you. I want to know you. More of you. Holy Spirit, I want to know you. More of you. More of you. And oh God, I ask for the spirit of prayer to come upon your people. I ask that you would breathe with a prayer anointing, with a hunger to gather corporately as well as in our closets, to press in out of the place of intimacy, out of the place of standing before you, keeping your charge, ministering to you. We can touch your heart. Set me as a seal on your heart. Set me as a seal on your arm. Do what you want to do through our prayers and our lives, but set me as a seal in your heart, God. I want to love you. I want to know what it means to stand before you. Oh! Pour it out, pour it out. Right now, all over the room, I just want to bless. Spirit of prayer, just anointing, a hunger for the place of intercession. The hunger of the place to meet with him day by day, to stand before him. Even for some, I feel there's some here, you're pointing to raise up prayer meetings and houses of prayer, and for pastors that God is gripping your heart with the importance of it. You know, sometimes it doesn't, we don't have a lot of people that show up, but it's the remnant that sanctifies the whole. It's like where God said, give me a remnant that will press in that place of prayer, and I will come. I will come. I will come. Let's be like Joshua and Caleb. Let's see that the land is fruitful. Let's go for it. Let's go to war. Let's go to war. And you know how we war? We war in worship. We war in prayer. We war. Even as Jehoshaphat learned to war, and the place of his battle position was to fall on his face and worship the Lord. That's how he learned to war. And the Lord said, the battle belongs to the Lord. The battle belongs to the Lord. Some of you, you need a fresh fire in your church. I know what that's like. Oh, the battle belongs to the Lord. We seek your face. We're coming, oh God. We will stand before you. We will take our place as priests before you. Oh, come. Move, Lord. Shift what needs to be shifted. Come, your glory. Breathe on us, Jesus. Let's worship him. Just encounter him in this place.
Thank you.
solid ground. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And Jesus, pick me up and you turn me around and you place my feet on the solid ground. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Pick me up and you turn me around and you place my feet on the solid ground. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Sing it to him, Lord, pick us up.
Pick me up and turn us around, God. And place my feet on the solid ground. Hallelujah,
have desired the Lord, and that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house all the days of my life, in the house of the Lord, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. And also David said in Psalm 26, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. God, we want to be a people of one thing. Oh God, we want to burn with a desire for you. We want to burn with a desire to seek your face, to dwell in your house the days of our life. God, we want to behold your beauty and inquire of you. So Lord, we pray right now that everyone here in this room, everyone, every child, every man, every woman, God, you would pierce our hearts to be men and women of one thing, just like David cried out, God, even as he was this man after your own heart, Lord. We thank you for even now, Lord, imparting and igniting a fire of one thing, a fire of a seeking heart, of a hungry and a thirsty spirit, Lord, that even when we leave this conference, we would pursue you, the prize, the upward call, oh, the pearl of great price. Oh, God, put us in us a discipline. Oh, God, set our face like flint to know you. Set us our heart, Lord, set our heart on you and the things of the eternal realm, God, that which goes on into eternity. Lord, we're asking for more. We're asking for a people of one thing, to be a people of one thing, to behold your beauty. Jesus, we pray.
Gaze upon your beauty, God. Oh God, make us people of one thing, one desire.
People of one thing.
We want to seek you, you alone, God.
See you, and as you are, see you. Oh, your
of the beauty.
Desire of the nations, and you're my desire.
Ooh, would you captivate us, fascinate
captivate us, God.
Captivate, fascinate.
Fascinate us, Lord. Your beauty. We would dialogue, we would love you. Lord, we ask.
worshiping. I just kept getting that God is releasing the oil and the wine. It's a new manifestation. It's a new anointing. Whoa. And then I looked over at the painting, and the oil and the wine were coming out of the bottle. And so I just released that today. In the name of Jesus, we decree that the oil and the wine is being released, and there's a new thing that God is doing, and it's going to manifest in every church represented in this place. Lord, we bless the oil and the wine to flow freely, flow freely, flow freely, and bring healing, life, deliverance, everything that is needed comes out of the oil and the wine, and the joy of the Lord is being released without measure today, in Jesus' name.
God, there is fullness of joy at your right hand, oh God. There are pleasures evermore in your presence, oh God. There is fullness of joy at your right hand, oh God. There are pleasures evermore in your presence, oh God. There is fullness of joy.
reason deep in my soul. Joy of the Lord, joy of the Lord, let it flow. We sing, let it spring from deep in my soul. Oh, let it spring from deep in my soul.
Actually, the good news is that Where's Chris? Chris waved at us from Australia, all the way from Australia to build the House of Prayer in Toronto. He's actually heading into the back right now to lead a two-hour set in the back chapel House of Prayer. So you can eat and go in there, or you can go in there and eat later, but I actually have to go pick up Heidi Baker at the airport so she can be here for tonight. So it's another awesome night tonight. Praise the Lord. Be filled with joy. Joy in the place of prayer. Joy in seeking His face. Joy in the Word of God. Amen. Be blessed. Thank you. Back at 7 o'clock or in the House of Prayer right now.